And welcome to another edition of State of the Eagles. David Moulton along with FGCU Athletic Director Ken Cavanaugh. Well, the last time that we sat down, it was a couple weeks before Irma, so a whole lot has transpired. We'll start with the fact of the room we're sitting in. So you've been talking about expansion and the new digs and what have you. So these are the new digs, huh?
These are the new digs, the new theater. Not only used by the teams from a functional standpoint for team film sessions and also just general meetings and recruiting, it's actually been used as a theater. Our women's swimming and diving team not too long ago showed Moana, a Disney film, in here with the recruits. So we're getting plenty of use for it, and it's an exciting part of the overall campaign and the expansion. We're just at a point right now we're looking forward to having the fruits of those labors come out with all these new facilities.
And obviously none of this happens without boosters, donors, and the list seems to be growing.
Well, it really is, and we are so blessed that being with the university just into our 21st year, and as we've said many times, our oldest alum is about 42 and our average alum is about 32. If it wasn't for the generous and heartwarming Southwest Florida community that have taken us under their wings, the whole university, but athletics certainly fits into that, wouldn't be where we are. And we had a really neat ceremony last week where we had a ribbon cutting ceremony with Dr. Martin and our major donors, the Beals, the Hartleys, the Shriners, and the Sublets are four couples in particular amongst many donors that were front and center for their contributions that have helped make this facility come to fruition. We're very blessed to have their names associated with our facilities now and look forward to others hopefully joining their ranks. But it really, again, does not get done without so much help out there. So to everyone involved with that, we say thank you very much.
Were any of the new digs or old digs damaged by Irma?
Old digs somewhat. We were really blessed, especially considering what we understand a number of other people in our community are still going through. But overall, the winds that came through did some damage at baseball, softball. We were real lucky. Soccer didn't get touched because we were in season and right. Had a game that week. But overall, we were blessed that we didn't get hurt worse. And this facility did a great job as a shelter. Mike Miller from our staff and Ruth Rodriguez and others did a wonderful job with that. So all being said, my first hurricane myself, we lasted pretty well. And this room actually worked pretty well. Coach Semesco and I and a few others watched Oklahoma Ohio State in here.
How about that? Hey, college football season continues, storms and all. All right, let's get to the fall season. Let's start with the cross-country programs, men and the women. Start wherever you'd like.
Well, the cross-country championship's always the first championships of the year for the A-Sun in our department, and we were hit with the injury bug, and we lost our top runner coming back from last year, Ronnie Greenup, to be potentially first-team all-conference again, and he was hurt, and we'll have him back next year, so that's, I guess, the half-full mentality. But we were in a position where the guys finished in fifth place, and the gals finished seventh. Carlin Berryhill, our sophomore, made all-conference again, as he did last year, second team. On the women's side, Carly Lutzow finished actually first team all conference. She finished seventh place. The issue with the women's team really was we were down to literally the minimum five runners. And our second best runner, Anita Munoz, who did a wonderful job speaking at our ribbon cutting ceremony last year for the new facility, unfortunately she fell and got a concussion just before the championships, which is a very rare injury in cross country. But when you're running outside and you trip or something, she was out. And with that, we were down to potentially could have been four runners, but the week or so prior to that, we had a really unique situation where we were down to five runners, knew if somebody got hurt, now thinking that we were going to have a concussion, we needed a little bit of depth. So they were, girls are running on campus, and literally ran into a young lady who was running, and they just said, hey, you ever run cross country? She had in high school. And with that, they asked if she'd be interested in joining the team, talked to Coach Cassandra, and next thing you know, Madeline Weirs was not only on the team, but she was the reason we got to run at the championships because she was our fifth runner. And really, those are things that make it look back in your career later on. What a wonderful story. Here's a young woman who really had no thought of ever participating in Division I athletics, and she became a key piece. If we didn't have five runners, we couldn't have run the race, we couldn't have finished, and we also would have lost the sport in terms of sponsoring for the year. So at the end of the year, Madeline, for the one race or two races she ran for us, will win her varsity letter in a way that she never envisioned a month ago.
Well, that's taking the definition of a walk-on, I think, to a whole new level. You have to retake the team picture.
Yeah, we do.
Something like that happens. I mean, she's got to be a part of
the team
picture.
Oh, no doubt. That is, well, point. We did tell our sports information staff we had to do that.
I mean, everything.
Yeah. Oh, no. She's earned it. And again, we had that happen last year with a men's tennis player. We had a number of injuries, and they found someone that joined the team and got us through a tough stretch when a couple guys were not cleared. So, you know, we just don't have depth of having that many individuals on our teams because of the limitations of terms of our budgeting, but also, you know, if somebody's not going to play and they really don't envision they're going to be able to play at the Division I level, it's a lot of time commitment that they'd
Absolutely.
Have to make. So that's a special story that we had, and look forward to giving Madeline her letter.
Well, speaking of injuries, though, the men's soccer team, I mean, even before the season started, it just seemed as if it was going to be one of those years, and the team pretty much had injuries throughout.
Yeah, it's a sport that's one of the higher injury rates to begin with, and you lose your All-American and the national leading returning scorer and Albert Ruiz, who had surgery in May, and we thought we'd get him back maybe at the beginning of the year, and he didn't get back till middle of the season. And then he played well and made first team All-Conference, which is a credit to him in such a short half season, but didn't have the ability to have the extra players with Kamar Marriott, who was All-Region preseason and in a position he never played all year long, and we just throughout the year we're dealing with not the same lineup. And the other thing is we've had such success on both the men's and women's side that there's a bullseye on our back, and we played a good non-conference schedule. Air Force, who's I believe in the top 15 in the RPI right now, Denver, who was in the College Cup last year, FIU is ranked in the top 15. We had them till late in the game and lost in a very tough overtime game. So we're playing good teams, and you don't have your full lineup in a sport like soccer where you never know, you could outshoot somebody 20-1 and that one shot goes in and the 20 don't. So we're looking forward to continuing off of the great group of seniors that left us in the best shape we've ever had, last year's run to the double overtime second round against North Carolina. So they've left a great legacy, and we look to build upon it.
And the men finished second in the regular season and got knocked out in the semifinals of the ASUN tournament. Meanwhile, the women, they win it, and they win it in dramatic, historic fashion, because you know, FGCU's done great things at home in terms of winning the ASUN. I believe this is the first time that the women win the ASUN on the road.
First time we've been on the road in the conference tournament, and this is our seventh year of eligibility and in a position where Lipscomb beat us in a big game a few weeks ago, earned the first seed. We wind up actually tying with them, which is the eighth straight and a record-setting performance for the ASUN to win eight straight championships. So with that, we had to go on the road, and on our semifinal, we took care of Jacksonville 2-0, and it was a really windy day, and the team with the win on their half scored all four of the regulation goals, and we were down 2-0 at half, battled back, tied it at 2, and it looked like we were heading toward penalty kicks, and lo and behold, Ashley Parks, our defensive player of the year, hit one up to Varen, and Varen wound up scoring a goal as we were getting ready to start penalty kicks. So it was just an exciting win, a beautiful day, two tough games between Lipscomb and FGCU, both on the men's and women's side that particular day, and we were glad we at least got a split, because the guys' game was already over, so that was the best we were going to get.
Well, think about it, down 2-0 at the half, and having to go on the road and to come back and win in overtime. I mean, been a lot of big wins in the history of this women's soccer program. That'd have to be one of the three best wins ever.
Oh, absolutely. Again, quality opponent in Lipscomb on their field and with the conditions that we had. And Jim had told that the ladies at halftime say, you know, we've never been in this position before on the road. And, you know, if what a way and an opportunity for you to set a new standard for the program. And here we are back to the NCAAs again.
Fourth straight year that the women's soccer program will be in the NCAA tournament. Volleyball has had some great moments this year. One tough road trip, couple of injuries, but season still ongoing. It's the one season that definitely loops over into the winter. But this team has a chance to be special.
No, we really starting to get, we only have one senior in Courtney Stevens who's done a great job as a captain with us, and now in a position where the upperclassmen, Amanda Carroll and Maggie Rick, in particular amongst the juniors, leading us in a position where they've gained season successes, and now we're heading toward the final week of the season. We have a big match coming up Friday and Saturday with Lipscomb and Kennesaw, who Kennesaw is in first place, and if we can have success this weekend, depending depending on how outcomes, we could possibly tie for the conference championship. If not, have a really good lead into the conference tournament in Nashville in 2 weeks, where we're going to hopefully potentially win our first ever NCAA bid. And Amanda Carroll, as a junior, has already established the kills record, broke Brooke Youngquist Sweats, which is a pretty nice name to be next to, record, and only as a junior. So we're in a position right now, we're trying to get some individuals, including Amanda, fully rested for the conference tournament. But 19 wins already, and it looks like Matt's got another 21 season to be proud of.
And the conference tournament in Nashville, where FGCU has already won this year. Great win against Lipscomb on the road earlier in the season. So they have a good feeling about competing on that court no matter what.
Yeah, and it's certainly over the recent years, just as we've been in soccer, Lipscomb's been the program that has pretty much dominated, and rightfully so, earned an at-large bid a few years ago. So, you know, nobody's counting the Bisons out, even if they're a fourth seed, which they probably will be. But it looks like right now, you know, there's a chance that we would not face them until the championship match, so it'd be nice to face them.
All right, 5 fall sports, 3 winter sports, and obviously basketball gets all the attention, but swimming actually gets the early start and is already off to a great start.
Yeah, we're 3-1. Had our first ever dual meet against Florida. Lost in an event up there where we actually won 4 different competitions. But you know, the Gators have been national champions, and it's a great benchmark for our team, for our gals, to get an opportunity to swim and swim in very competitive races. That even if you don't win and you get better times, which we did, we had a lot of personal bests for the year. Create potential opportunities down the road, not only for our team to know that they've competed against quality competition, but hopefully post some times to go to the NCAA. So last I knew, we were ranked around 30th in the country again in terms of their rankings, and look forward to having another CCSA championship to use to go into the NCAAs.
Well, you mentioned rankings, and while the women's basketball team is not ranked, they've received preseason votes. I think the most preseason votes have received in the 16 years, 11 Division I that Carl Semesco and company have been playing Division I basketball. They're the pick again by the coaches and the media to win the A-Sun. A lot of returning players, where a year ago at this time, it was like 9 newcomers.
Yeah, Carl certainly has earned the respect of everybody in terms of don't doubt Carl. And we've got a great non-conference schedule. We open up on Sunday against Illinois. We're in a position, we have Kentucky, who's been a top 16, Elite 8 team in recent years, coming here as well. So, you know, we've got an opportunity to go out to Las Vegas and play DePaul and Ohio State and Stanford. 2 other top 10 teams are in there. So the great scenario of playing good competition and then being ready for the A-Sun is something that we're looking forward to. And Rain 3 is as we're doing along the way.
And think about that. 2 Power 5 schools that are coming to Alico Arena. That doesn't happen very often. Season opener against Illinois, and it's a Friday night when FGC will be hosting Kentucky, and the Wildcats very likely will be nationally ranked. They've been a top 15 program for about the last 5 years. The men have an excellent schedule. I mean, open with Illinois State, but also home and homes against Middle Tennessee State. You take a look at the mid-major top 25, there's like 6 teams on it that FGCU have to play.
Yeah, first of all, as it is for Carl every year, it's a challenge to, as we've continued to grow our program, you get in that position. I guess it's a backhanded compliment where nobody wants to play you because you're they're at risk losing to you. And we're in a position where we found other fellow mid-majors, as you mentioned, Illinois State, who we open up with this coming weekend. We're co-champions of the Missouri Valley Conference last year with Wichita State.
Who should have gotten a bid. I mean, yeah. What, 25 wins and didn't get an at-large?
Yeah, and they're going to be the team that should win the league this year outright because Wichita now moving into the AAC. So we've got a great opportunity to start the season at home. We hope that we'll get a sellout. Then we're in a position, the Middle Tennessee State, for people who don't realize, they've, each of the last 2 years, I think they've beaten Michigan State and Minnesota in the NCAA tournament.
As a 15, yeah. Beat Michigan State a couple years ago.
And thankfully, they didn't get the second win,
right.
So we're still holding our placement. But, you know, we've got quality there. We're going to play at Siena, at Bowling Green. We've got Oral Roberts at home, who's had competitive teams in recent years. And then we have a nice tournament at Thanksgiving where we have Navy, Denver, and St. Francis coming in. So it's a good balance. We'll go to Wichita State on the road around Christmas time. And then right after Christmas, we go to Rhode Island.
Right. Very good team.
Yeah. So it's considered probably overall the top mid-major schedule in the country. And, you know, again, we just try to continue to balance what is the best way to get enough home games and not put our team on the road too often, but also challenge ourselves for the postseason.
Men were also picked by the coaches and the media to win the A-Sun. Both teams are very deep. I could argue maybe the two deepest teams that they have both brought to the table in their history.
Well, the women, though, I think a little bit less so than the men, because they've got three individuals that are sitting out this year as transfers that can't play this year. But from an overall number, coming back, like you said earlier, and the number of individuals that have, you know, China and Rose and so forth that have put up good numbers coming back. On the guys' side, I would say it's not only our deepest, it's our most talented team. The depth that we have at the guard position with all the guys that have had experience in the NCAA, and then you add in Ricky and Michael Gilmore and Brady with their experience at Michigan and VCU and Iowa State, those practices have been really competitive. And I think that's how a mark of a really good team is, if you can get good in practice, because your competition in practice is game-like. And that's what we've seen. And I think Joe and his staff have done a great job building that nucleus. And in turn, Carl's staff has done the same. Just, I think the men's really deep.
All right. Well, the big question as we wrap things up, I mean, Dr. Bradshaw, I mean, he darn near wore the mascot costume. Can you tell us about Dr. Martin here? I mean, we know he's a big sports fan just from the schools that he's been at. He wouldn't have been able to stay gainfully employed if he wasn't a big sports fan. But, I mean, you know, what are we going to get here? Is he going to be in the Dirty Bird section? Is he going to be up in the suite? Is he going to travel on the road? I mean, come on. These are big, big questions.
Well, we can't give up the game plan early. Dr. Martin, as Dr. Bradshaw, is just a tremendous supporter. His background includes being at LSU when they won the College World Series. He's been at New Mexico State. We all know the tremendous support that we got from Brad and Joanna, and we look forward to Mike and Jan, who have already been at volleyball and soccer and other sports, to continue to be there and support us. And we are very appreciative of that. We know how busy their schedules are, and at the same time, we hope that we provide them not only pride, but a nice outlet on their own free time to come out and root the Eagles on, as we do all our teams. And it's another scenario where we got off to a great start. Our fans have been a key piece of that. We're certainly hoping that during the course of the rest of the year, if you haven't been, that you'll come out to games and you'll help us get that home field court, whatever advantage it is, to have another terrific year.
Well, it's also something that doesn't happen at every university. FGCU has been fortunate in many little ways, and one of them is that every single president at the university has really liked the sports.
Well, and that again, that's helpful. I think it that feeling of basically putting on another opportunity for someone to just basically reinforcing how important athletics is for the university. We know where we fit in the overall scheme of things, but we take a lot of pride in being an opportunity for the university to get additional positive exposure. And it doesn't always have to be a great star like Chris Sale. It could just be doing things that we need to do on a daily basis in the community. And certainly we are very fortunate to be successful, and the women's soccer team going back to the NCAA is hopefully the first of many teams to do that this year. So we're looking forward to that.
Chris Sale, huh? Whatever happened to him? For Ken Cavanaugh, I'm David Moulton. Thanks so much for watching another edition of State of the Eagles. We will keep you updated throughout the winter season as to how things are going. Thanks for your time. We'll talk again soon.